I was a little bit terrified actually coming out here in heels because, as you would know, I'm actually a water animal. I'm not a very good land animal. So if I trip over, that's because that's why. Can I please see a show of hands of who knows what an outlier is? Okay, that's about as many as I thought. Please keep your hands raised if you think you are an outlier or you at least have the makings to be an outlier. Fantastic. Oh, yes, I can see more. That's fantastic. Well, for those of you who don't know what an outlier is in statistics, which, mind you, I got a 5 at uni for, which I'm pretty stoked about, an outlier is an observation point that is distant from other observations, making that person very special and very unique. I really hope by the end of my talk today you will realise that you all have the makings to be an outlier, to be that very special person. And I will show you with the 3 lessons I have learned throughout my swimming career. When I sat down and thought about what I wanted to talk to you today, most of the talks I do are all about swimming, but I really couldn't get this idea of outliers out of my mind. It was really fascinating. And in Malcolm Gladwell's aptly named book, Outliers, he talks about something called the 10,000 hour rule, which I'm sure you're all very familiar with. And I thought about it, I was like, it's really interesting, 10,000 hours to be a master at something. So let me think about how many hours it took for me to win this, an Olympic gold medal. Now please excuse the photo, as swimmers we don't get the opportunity to do our hair and makeup before our presentation, so my hair is always wet. It's actually dry today, which is really lovely. So I sat down and I thought about the hours that I'd spent swimming on my way to Olympic gold. And so you'll have to follow me a little bit here. These are the multiplications that I did. I did 10 swimming sessions a week, each session 2 hours long, making 20 hours of swimming a week. 20 hours a week multiplied by 48 weeks in the year. Yes, I was very lucky, I got 4 weeks off every year as a maximum, never more than that, equals 960 hours of swimming a year. 960 hours of swimming a year multiplied by 10 years, the age of 13 to 23 when I won. This is not including the time from the age of 2 to 13 or 23 to 27 when I retired, equals a total of 9,600 hours of swimming to win an Olympic gold medal. Now, when you see that number, you might be like me as well and go, oh, but she fell 400 short. Well, on top of that are the hours that I spent doing yoga, Pilates, boxing, ab work, gym work, altitude training at 3,500 meters above sea level. Yeah, that's about it. Add on top of that, now I'm being very conservative when I say this total, 3,000 hours on top of that gives you a grand total of 12,600 hours of training to win an Olympic gold medal. Now I can honestly say delayed gratification is something I very much appreciate and very much respect. Now looking at those 12,600 hours on a whole, I definitely don't think I could have done it if I hadn't overcome roadblocks. Now let me tell you, this journey was not smooth sailing. Although I have tried sailing, it's an excellent sport, so I can add that to my list of 3,000 hours. My roadblocks came in the form of probably 2 major roadblocks that I had to overcome. The first one, and I won't harp on this one, but it is quite interesting, is overcoming public criticism. Now, I don't know that any of you have actually experienced this, but being called fat on the front page of the paper is not very glamorous, but you do know you've made it when you get called fat on the front page of the paper and Whoopi Goldberg defends you on The View. Boom! Made it. I can retire now, very happy. So as you can imagine, insert your name here and fat after it. It's really not that nice, but it is actually really funny to think about now. The second roadblock that I had to actually overcome, and this was the biggest hurdle that I've ever overcome and I still use it now, was actually my mind. And a lot of you will probably think that you'll have to overcome your mind as well on probably a daily basis. But when I was young, and I hope I'm still young, but when I was 15 and at my first Olympics, I actually made the team at 14 but turned 15 just before the Olympics, so I was very old. And you could just imagine me sitting in the marshalling area just as a little 15-year-old girl, and I've got my idols on either side of me, including Amanda Beard and Penny Haynes. This was terrifying. I was actually coached to believe, now coaches teach people this, which is terrifying, I was actually coached to believe that my competitors were my enemies. These people were not my friends. They were to be respected, but you did not talk to them. These people were to be feared, and I was actually led to believe that they couldn't be beaten because these were the idols in my sport at the time. Unfortunately, it wasn't until very late in my career that I actually realized that these people could be beaten, and by me. And once I started to do that, I actually loved the sport. And the key here to overcoming roadblocks was I needed to be true to myself. I was coached to believe that these people were my enemies, but I actually wasn't being true to myself in the marching area. I was sitting there and not talking to anyone. Now, any of you who have spoken to me today, you'll probably realize that I'm pretty sort of out there and pretty extravagant sometimes. The true me was actually dancing, being totally ridiculous, singing, and talking to anyone who would listen to me in the marching area. Now, this actually had a double whammy effect, because not only was I being true to myself by talking, but I was actually distracting all my other competitors who did not want to be spoken to at the time. They hated it. As soon as they saw me walking into the marching area, they were like, hide, get away from her, don't talk to her. So once I realized that I could be myself in the marching area, I could overcome this sense that my mind was against me. These people weren't my enemies. I could respect them, but I could also beat them as well. The third key in my success is finding fulfilling work. Those 12,600 hours that you see there, I couldn't have done it if I looked at it as a whole. When you're sitting there and thinking about what your dream is, 10,000 hours seems so extravagant. It seems like so many hours, but it's actually not if your job is fulfilling. I walk around the city sometimes and I see people with these miserable looks on their faces. They don't want to go to work. They look absolutely terrible. And I just feel so sorry for them. And look, it could be a multitude of things. I don't know what's going on in their life, but I think sometimes it can be one of two things. One could be they are living their life by definition of someone else's success, whether it be a big house, a fast car, or earning a lot of money. You will never find fulfilling work if you live your life defined by someone else's version of success. Or the second thing is, which I've thought about a lot, maybe so many people are too scared to live outside their comfort zone. Let me tell you, nothing magical happens in your comfort zone. So many people do it every day. Perhaps they're too scared to do that dream, to live that life that they really want to live because, well, the pay packet comes in every week. That little bit of money that I get, yeah, it's pretty safe. That's your comfort zone. Nothing magical happens there. I'm telling you, I live every day of my life outside my comfort zone when I swim, including hours of hard work and sometimes public speaking. But you've got to do something every day that terrifies you. Public speaking terrifies me and I'm up here doing it. You've got to find something that fulfills you every day. Otherwise, you will never, ever be able to do the 10,000 hours to be a master at something and therefore become an outlier. I think about fulfilling work for myself now that I've retired from swimming, and as you've seen this week, the troubles with Ian Thorpe, it can be very difficult for an elite athlete when they retire to move into another career and another two-thirds of our life to go. But that dream for me now looks like a very extravagant, very expensive day spa, and I want it to be one of the most successful in Australia. That is my big dream now. It's going to take me 10,000 hours to get there, but I'm willing to do it because I reckon I would find the job very fulfilling. I'd be very happy to give people facials and spray tans if they felt beautiful when they left, guys included. You're very welcome. But that's a job that I would find fulfilling. And that's why I reckon I could be a success. So sometimes my mind comes into play again and it asks me questions like, why the hell do you think you deserve to own a successful day spa? You had your glory when you were a swimmer. Well, I answer myself now and realize I find the job fulfilling, I'm willing to overcome roadblocks, and I'm willing to work hard. So why the hell don't I deserve the success to open a day spa? And I ask that question exactly the same of you. Why the hell don't you deserve to be the best when you want to work hard, you're willing to overcome roadblocks, and you find the job fulfilling? You definitely do deserve it. Now, I want to ask you to work a little bit hard right now. Look, I'm not going to get you to get up and dance or do anything silly. In a moment, I would actually like you to close your eyes, and I'm going to give you 10 seconds. And I want you to think about that topic that really makes your face light up when you talk to friends and family about it. You could go on for days about it. Hell, you could probably even get up here and do a TED talk about it. You love this topic so much. So if you could please close your eyes and please think about this topic. Okay, open your eyes. That thing you just thought of, that's the thing you should go and do. And that's the thing you should be awesome at. Because that's where the magic happens, well outside your comfort zone. That topic that really makes your face light up, that's the thing you should go and do, and you should go and be awesome at it. Now, at the start of my talk, when I asked you who thinks they are an outlier or thinks they have the capability of being an outlier, I asked you that question again. Who thinks they have the capability of being an outlier? Excellent, that's exactly what I wanted to see. Go forth, be awesome, thank you very much.